If you are a creature that lives in and moves about in shells, there's a very fun scientific term that describes your lifestyle. It is conchocaly, which is a very fun and it's got a good pleasing mouthfeel. Conchocaly. Conchicoly. And if you live in a shell as a human, that term is just called depression. It's fine. Real talk. Talk about your feelings. Someone will be there to offer a shoulder or to help. Conchicoly. And welcome to another edition of Footnotes, the companion show to Because Science, where I take all of your comments, questions, and corrections, and I bust out of a shell of science to answer them. And then I tell you what's coming up next on this here very channel. Hint, it's about an apocalypse, but I'm not evil. Very important to know. But getting right down into it, in the last episode of Because Science, what's that? No, I was just getting to it. Okay. We were going back to the Witcherverse to try to figure out how a Witcher's silver sword works. You asked for it, so we did the science in this here video you can find on YouTube if you haven't seen it yet. I said that because silver, like many metals, has an oligodynamic effect. It's a biocide to certain types of organisms. If those organisms had a similar biology to the monsters on the continent, then maybe a silver sword would do well at slashing a siren. There we go. But we already talked about that. What I want to know is, what did you have to say? Oh yeah, it's solid metal. Our first comment comes from frequent commenter Carrie Noir, Private Eye, who says, how much silver would we as humans have to ingest for it to harm or damage us and our cells? I would answer this question, but another commenter, Talus Blue, comments right underneath Carrie and says, it's not clear how much colloidal silver, a silver that is suspended in a solution, like silver particles in something like water dissolved into it. We don't know how much may be harmful, but it can build up in your body's tissues over months or years. That is that it bioaccumulates. Your body doesn't naturally get rid of it, and so if you have it over time, it'll just build up in your body until it is toxic. The same thing happens with mercury and mercury in fish that eat other things infected with mercury and so on. Most commonly, this exposure results in argyria. I knew that. Which is a blue-gray discoloration of your skin, eyes, internal organs, nails, and gums. As it kills pathogens, I would say, when it starts affecting your gut bacteria. So argyria is nothing to mess around with, as you can see from a picture of this man who looks like a Smurf. It's not funny, he died. But he had so much silver exposure, I believe he was living near a silver mine or something, or taking colloidal silver, one of the two, it turned him completely blue, and it didn't turn out well. So yeah, silver can handle monsters, but it can also handle men. The dose makes the poison. Anything can be toxic. Even water can be toxic. There are reports in the medical literature, for example, of marathon runners dying by drinking too much water. I mean, everything has a lethal dose. Water, sugar, salt, all that stuff. It just depends on how much you take. We think of toxicity in terms of how little it would take to kill you, but everything's toxic. Just go on the internet. Looking at you, Twitter. Our next comment comes from frequent commenter God So Loved, who says, hey Kyle, love the show. Oh. I only have one highly scientific question. How do you know what a drowner's butt tastes like? Are you creating an army of them in your villainous lair? And if you are, why would you bite their butts? Also, can you answer this while keeping a straight face in the first take? Nummy num, drowner bum. What you may not know about Footnotes is I do this entire show in one take. I don't really redo any questions or anything that I say. It's all kind of out of drowner butt. You need the essence of drowner butt combined with wolf's bane to form an effective oil against Ikimara. But every experienced witcher knows that. I have no emotions, but I'm laughing. One take. HYX says, Kyle, you can't fool me. I know you're really Gaunter O'Dim, and I will never strike a deal with you. Wink. Real life emojis are dumb. Look, there's no way you can prove that I'm Gaunter O'Dim, Master Mirror, the devil himself. Then I would have to put a scar on your face, noting that you serve me for all time, or at least until you fulfill my wishes, and then you have to get a red-haired guy who has an undercut somehow like 300 years ago, even though that's a very modern haircut, to get me to dance with his dead brother and then do the other quests. The Witcher 3 DLC is fantastic. What was I talking about? Our next comment comes from Mr. Stevie Boy Wonder, who says, "Hey Kyle, love the show. I'm an electrical apprentice in my day job. I love when technical people comment. It's the best kind of comment, technically. As part of our uniform, we cannot wear jewelry made of metals because of their conductivity, like silver's extreme conductivity. One of my coworkers actually lost a finger due to his gold wedding ring getting shocked by high voltage, low amps, which superheated the ring and welded it to his skin." Yeah, electricity is nothing to mess around with. I saw some pretty gnarly photos in engineering school that they showed us on day one of why you shouldn't try to steal copper wire out of buildings. It makes it look like Igni was used on you. I have nothing more to add. That sucks. Sorry. But the nerdiest comment at the time I'm filming this episode, I gotta give to, he says his name is Tom because it's hard to pronounce, but I know it's Tomasz. You think I don't know Polish men's names? Wrong. Who says, "Hey Kyle, love the show." Thank you. I put my whole existence into it. He says, as a side note, not all monsters are susceptible to silver. He then goes on to mention a lot of context for the silver episode that we were talking about, even mentioning silver nanoparticles, which I described in some of the studies that we referenced in that very episode, and then goes on to say silver deals more damage than other metals to monsters and can disrupt their supernatural abilities, meaning that silver has only magical effects, or both magical and physical effects on monsters, unless their abilities are not magical but super physical. But that couldn't realistically exist because for super regeneration, a humongous amount of energy would be required for invisibility along with other complex features. That would just be quite impossible for that to exist, like for Bruxa. Kind regards from Poland. I knew it. I will admit, the explanation for why silver swords hurt monsters in the Witcherverse is probably a little bit more complicated than we made it. I just wanted to cover this very basic antimicrobial biocide-like effect because I thought it was very interesting. But that's what I love about the Witcher games and the books. They go into this in detail. They say why this happens. How does magic and physics interplay? I think the best world building incorporates all those ideas into one internally consistent picture. And for pointing that out, Tomasz, you are indeed a super nerd. Hello from the void. I don't know where it is in relation to Poland. But of course, I'm not always right. What's that? Oh, correction of power. It's gotta be. Our first correction comes from Nicholas Ramirez, who says, "Hey Kyle, love the show." You guys make me feel so good. "I'm a licensed veterinary technician." Thank you so much. I've been to a lot of vets in the last couple months and I appreciate it. "And in veterinary medicine, we use a silver-based cream as not only antibacterial treatment, but also as an antifungal treatment as well. The application of silver has gone beyond just the dark ages when we didn't have pharmaceuticals and antibiotics and that kind of thing. We still use it for a number of treatments on humans and in our animal friends as well." Thanks for pointing that out. Our second correction comes from Jordan Stokes, who says, "In Greek philosophy, self-reflection was seen as a path to self-fulfillment and living a good life. Mercury and silver could provide a literal reflection and were thought to help in this self-reflection process. What is cool is that monster stories have been used to demonstrate and to get people to come face to face with human flaws. Because silver and mercury were seen as a pathway to encouraging purity, people started saying that weapons of silver were super effective against monsters. They believed that self-reflection could destroy the monsters inside of men, too. Such a cool instance of how the process of mythology, fantasy, and reality can meld together to give us some really great stories." Yes. Our next correction comes from El Weasel, which means the weasel in Spanish, who says, "Hey Kyle, great show, arbitrary compliment. It's not arbitrary if I love it. The steel sword has a different guard than you showed in your episode. Only the silver sword has the sharply angled guard. The silver sword has the V-shaped guard, and the steel, like the T in steel, has more of a T-shaped guard. And I got that wrong because it was gonna take too long to change all the animations." All right, you got me. Our next correction comes from DollSkin7, gross, who says, "But if it takes a few ions to kill bacteria, wouldn't it take then a lot of silver to give a monster some lethal poisoning, at least more than what is delivered in 1 to 5 strikes?" Well, have you ever fought a fiend without relic oil on your sword? That can take on Death March difficulty in The Witcher 3 Wild Hunt? With no bombs? That could take like 20 minutes if you're trying to get the Chivo. Which I did. But I agree with your correction. It would take a lot of material transferring off of the sword to to the monster to give it what we would consider for like a human-sized organism, a lethal dose. So that leads me to believe that if we are correct in thinking that this oligodynamic effect has something to do with why monsters are susceptible to silver, that the monsters in the Witcherverse are much, much, much more sensitive to silver than the average microbe. That would be my explanation. But the nerdiest correction at the time I'm filming this episode, I gotta give to Series Gaming, who says, "Hey Kyle, I really, really love the show. I'm not just saying it to get into footnotes, I really mean it." Well, hey, look what happened. Thank you. I'm a med student. Good luck. So I have quite a bit of knowledge about cellular biology, and I noticed that when you were talking about the effects of silver on bacteria, you mentioned some organelles, like mitochondria, the powerhouse of the cell, which are exclusive to eukaryotic cells, and bacteria, which is a prokaryotic cell. They wouldn't have those. With your diagram and organelle explanation, you would have been able to explain the effect of silver in a protist organism, which is a unicellular eukaryotic organism. Also, when silver enters the cell, it may bind to certain enzymes, inhibiting the proper function, or changing the structure, and that would be catastrophic for any organism. Good point. So in my diagram of what silver can do to microbe cells, I had organelles in there, nucleus in there containing DNA, mitochondria, the endoplasmic reticulum. You've taken biology, and that wouldn't appear in all microbes. So if you go back to the study that I was referencing for this, which looks at silver nanoparticles and their antimicrobial effect, it says that these nanoparticles have been proven effective against over 650 microorganisms, including bacteria, fungi, and viruses. So some of these other organisms would have the mitochondria that you're speaking of. So if we're talking about just bacteria, then my explanation wouldn't work. But we're talking about a number, hundreds of different microorganisms, and if Witcher monster biology had similar biology to some of those, then our explanation starts to work. And then you might still have to introduce a little bit of magical purity kind of stuff into it, but I like where our explanation is going. But for making sure we're still being honest about what we're talking about, Series Gaming, you are indeed a super nerd. Look at you on Footnotes now. Good luck in med school. Now, moving right along to this week's episode of Because Science. This week's episode is, what would happen if the sun exploded? That's right, in this week's episode of Because Science, we are going through a fun thought experiment and thinking about what would happen if our sun exploded. What would happen to the humans on Earth? Could they survive? What would be the mechanism of their demise? Is there any way to stop it? You're gonna have to watch the episode to find out. But before we find out about supernovae and exploding suns, please go watch the latest episode of Because Science if you haven't yet, all about The Witcher. Silver swords, and leave me your best, nerdiest comments, corrections, and questions at youtube.com/becauseScience, facebook.com/becauseScience, and at becauseScience on Instagram and the theater. And don't forget, catnip is the only hallucinogen that we recreationally give to animals. You're making your cat trip.